So, all right. So, this week, I have two projects that I'm currently working on, but they're not going to be done in time. And I don't want to rush them because they're very detailed. Also, next week, well, not next week, that'd be 2 weeks, in a future but soon later date, a tool will be arriving that is going to be game-changing for this channel, and I'm very, very excited about it. I've wanted one for a very long time, and I'm not saying what it is because I don't want to ruin that surprise. So with those things being said, I figured this week we should do something a little bit mellow. So we are going to paint.
Now I know what you're probably thinking. I know we're not building anything this week, but when I started this channel, I said I wanted to do all things creative. I've actually been a painter longer than I've been a carver, so this just was gonna happen at some point. I'm excited. What are we making? I don't know yet. Put a background on first, and then I'll see how I feel.
We literally haven't even started yet, and I already have paint on myself.
Okay, let's begin. And we're going to begin by laying down a sky. We have a nice background sky gradient going. So normally this would take 67 years to dry, but I don't want to wait that long. So we're gonna cheat, and I'm gonna just, you know, kinda. All right, so the important thing to keep in mind with landscape paintings is that you need to start at the furthest back point and move forward. Cause it's kinda weird if you try doing it the other way. I mean, like, you're not weird if you do that, I'm just saying I couldn't do that. So we're gonna make some clouds. I'm out of sponge, so we're gonna just, I textured this little piece of foam, see if it works. A little bit, not really. I'm gonna find something better than this, because I don't like this. This ain't working.
There, that's better.
I'm just gonna dab some of this stuff out here. I'm starting with gray, and we're gonna come back with just plain white.
Okay, so we've got a baseline down.
So now I'm gonna come back in with actually dark gray. We're gonna shade some spots, because no cloud is pure white, except for the clouds that are. Usually they have a little bit of shadow inside of the cloud, but adding a little bit of gray will add some dimension to our clouds. And now we can come in with pure white in very specific spots to kind of highlight stuff. And there's our cloud. Gonna be doing this a lot today. Time has come to add some mountains. So I'm gonna mix some blue with some gray. I don't have enough white. Oh no, I don't have enough white.
Oh no.
Actually, that's fine. So we have a blue-gray. Now I'm gonna add a touch of raw umber. We're gonna wind up with a color that looks somewhat like that. Not quite blue, not quite gray, not quite black, but something that resembles all of them.
And also none of them.
All right, and I am gonna start defining our ridge line. What I'm doing right here is a good way to differentiate perspective. Distance. The atmosphere itself makes things appear more blue and light the farther away they are, which means the darker this mountain is, it'll make your eyes believe that it's closer. So the further back we go, I'm actually gonna add white and a little bit more blue. So next we need to decide where our light source is gonna be. And just, you know, to keep myself from having to make way more work for myself, we'll do that later in another video. I don't wanna deal with dynamic lighting. So the sun is right here. If we do this, we have to do shadows and coming through. I don't wanna do that right now. We've textured our mountains. It may look like noise at the moment. Trust me, we're gonna bring it back down. So now we need to add in our happy little distant trees. I'm gonna do that by just stippling green pretty much everywhere. So we have sky, clouds, mountains, detail on mountains, trees. Before we move to the foreground, we have to do one more thing, and that is glaze. So here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna take some of this sky blue, pour a good amount of that in there. I'm gonna take some of this pinkish purple tone. It's more of a lavender, I guess. Put a little bit in there. The itty bittiest, tiniest amount of burnt umber, and then just add water. Now, we're
gonna get a paper towel ready, dip my brush into my glaze, and then we're gonna paint it on. Once that's painted on, take a paper towel, and we are gonna dab it off. And what that does is it kind of creates a haze over the distance, the stuff that is far away. That helps create perspective, but it also helps blur stuff, if that makes sense. And it really defines your layers. Like, you can tell this is way farther back than either of these now. Which is why I was saying don't worry when it looked muddy, because it will get fixed with a glaze. There, I intentionally didn't go all the way down right there so I could show you guys. It is a very slight difference, but you zoom out, hold it up, it really does help a lot. There, now check out how much softer those layers are. They don't all look like right up on top of each other. You can really tell the difference in the, you know, perspective. Background is done. Now let us move on to create the foreground. I'm sure this sounds weird and wrong. We want a nice, clear lake. You'd think blue, right? Wrong. We want phthalo green. Oh, this is turquoise green. Where's my phthalo? Now we come in with phthalo. Blue, sorry. So now we're gonna come in with this color, this sandy color, muddy color actually, and I'm gonna start creating the bank of the lake, river, reservoir, body of water. You've got that laid out. You can basically treat background and foreground as two halves of a painting. So obviously we start with backgrounds, background being the lake, then clouds, which would be the, you know, stuff in this case, and then that's when we started adding in our mountains in layers. So just like that, we're going to start from the back and work our way forward. So first things first, I'm going to put a line of trees right back here. So we're going to come in with this, which is raw umber. Problem with some paints, see that? Probably hard to tell. Some paints are fairly transparent, so we need to make that more opaque. We do that by adding some white. Oh yeah, probably also I have some. Sorry, my paintbrush is in my mouth because I'm a freaking heathen. Adding some black and then introducing the color again. Brings us back to basically the same color we would have had beforehand, but it is way more opaque, which is important when you're putting paint on top of other strongly colored paint. So now we have the foreground's background done. You track that statement. Alexis just gave me this. What are you talking about? That's an inside joke, Alexis. You'll have to watch the...
Again?
No, you know I don't drink. So now what we're gonna do is we're gonna come in to this little area right here, probably one right here, and we're gonna make big ol' boulders. And then after the boulders, we're gonna come in along all of the bank line and add rocks. Alright, so we have shadows and highlights on all of the rocks. So now we're going to come back in with the original rock color, and we're going to just dry brush. That's going to soften those lines, because most boulders don't just have hard lines like that. It's going to be more modeled. And
And then the last thing we're going to do with these rocks is we're going to mix up some gray to pretty much match our rock tone. And I'm going to take some burnt umber and mix that in. And that is going to give us a sort of a brown gray. And then we're going to come in with this and dry brush over all the rocks again in random spots. And that's going to give a little more natural color. Because again, boulders ain't usually just gray. Our next order of business is shrubbery. We need to add some detail in the water, like ripples and stuff. So let's do that. A really good way to get nice, effective, ripple pattern looking things is not actually to come in and do little squigglies. You'd think it would be, but no, squigglies are not always the answer. Actually, what is the best way I've found to do it is you take a tone that is slightly lighter than the water itself, and then you just dry brush. I'm sorry. Oh gosh, my camera fell over. Sorry about this horrible glare, by the way. There's really nothing I can do about that, because my overhead light is just doing that, no matter how I angle this thing. There, I can't paint like this because it's too far away, but I could set it up to get rid of that glare to show you what I mean. See, so we came in with just a slightly lighter color, just to add the ripple, and that's actually really all it needs. It's pretty much that easy. Okay, now we can do the thing I was going to do that I was talking about that I got ahead of myself in. So the intention here is a crystal clear lake, which means the closer we get to the foreground, it actually needs to turn brown. I know, weird concept, but it actually needs to kind of move toward a more soil color because of the, you know, you're seeing the you know, what is it called? Lake bed, I guess. I don't know. Wow, that should not have been such a struggle. So instead of just going brown, we're actually gonna mix up some brown and mix it with the lightest color of the water so that we can kind of blend them into each other. I've decided I want a log jam over here. So that's what we're doing. Okay, so we finished this foreground element, which means now we can come to this, which is actually the foremost ground element. I know what we're gonna do. I mean, this is a painting video after all. It would be a crime for us to not put a happy tree. And next, we're gonna mix up a sort of a woody green. Which is just lime green, black, and a bunch of brown. And then I'm gonna just stipple this all over this area right here. Thought I was recording. Then I just added white and did more stippling. Now I'm gonna stipple on some red. And I'm gonna add more plants up close, like right in the foreground. Going to take some lavender. And some white. And you know what? We're going to be wild and reckless. I think I want another splash of color, so we're going to do yellow as well. I know what you're thinking. I'm out of hand at this point. Yellow too? How scandalous. Alrighty. And with that, we are done. Here it is. And it looks so good. We got our sun and our mountains and the forest, also a rainbow. There's a carp squid. Remember, carp squid, his name's Tony. And there's me, but a pirate. And the Mickey Mouse symbol because Disney owns everything. You know what? I'm starting to think that this isn't the painting we just worked on. Huh, let's try this again.
guys. Well, there you have it. That is how you paint a mountain landscape in 27 to 73 easy steps.
I am super happy with how it came out, especially considering I didn't really spend a whole lot of time on it. This only took about 6 hours. Which is actually saying something because
this is actually not a small canvas. This is pretty big.
I freaking love painting. It has been a love of mine for a very, very long time. I've been painting longer than I've been into rocks, so that's saying something.
You can treat this video as entertainment or a tutorial, depending on how you're feeling at any given moment.
Let me know what you guys thought down in the comments, and also let me know if you guys would like to see more painting. This is actually like a fairly simple one. Compared to, you know, if I like gave it more time, this was a one day project, which is unheard of on this channel.
It's something I love to do, and I would love to do it again if you guys want to see more of it. And it'll be fun to get one of those gigantic canvases and just spend like 4 weeks painting some crazy thing. I think it'd be awesome.
All right, guys. Well, I think that is going to do it for this one. Let me know what you think down in the comments. Let me know if you want to see more painting, because I'm down always. As I said earlier, I have two projects that I'm currently working on. Those are probably going to be in the wings for a little bit, because the next video, if all goes according to plan, we have a new tool to play with, and I'm so freaking excited. I'll have links to stuffs and whatnot up in the description. But yeah, that's going to do it for this one. I hope you all enjoyed, and I'll see you next time.
Happy little tree.